Cronos project. Well, it's the time of the year that the year is ending and New Year is coming. So there's going to be New Year's firework. So let's talk about rockets, right? So yes, Thanos exactly. Here. Thanos, he will. He's the team leader of the student team called White Noise.
Yes.
Exactly. Interesting name. Maybe you can also then explain where this comes from. He's an undergraduate at Technical University of Athens, and yeah, he's going to show us how to open source build our fireworks.
We hope that it won't become a firework. We hope that it will fly. Anyway, so my name is Thanos Patsas. I am the team leader of the student team White Noise, and I'm going to present you our last project. Is called Cronos. It's a completely SRAD and open source sounding rocket. SRAD means student researched and designed, and we borrowed that term from the competition that we're attending next year. We're going to the Spaceport America Cup, Intercollegiate Rocket Engineering Competition, and among others, it splits the competitors into two big subcategories, SRAD versus COTS, COTS being commercial of the self, and SRAD being student researched and designed. So we developed the rocket under the auspices of Libre Space Foundation. So some words about our propulsion system. It's not like a firework, because the firework, you have an engine, you light it up and it goes. Ours, it has valves, oxidizers, and run tanks, etc. So we have a solid fuel inside the combustion chamber burning. We feed it with oxidizer, liquid nitrous oxide in our case, from the external run tank shown in the photo. Here you can see the Mark 1 engine that we designed. So some general details about Cronos. It's going to reach an apogee of 3 kilometers, a max velocity of 0.86 Mach, a max acceleration of 10.3 Gs, and it weighs 30 kilograms wet with all the propellants and all of that stuff, and dry 23.32 kilograms. As I mentioned before, it utilizes nitrous oxide and paraffin as oxidizer and fuel respectively, 5.68 kilograms of N2O and 1 kilogram of paraffin. So the M3000 Mark II, it's the engine that will fly eventually with Cronos. It weighs 9.36 kilograms, it uses paraffin and N2O, and it is estimated to produce 3,000 newtons of thrust for 3 seconds. Here you can see the CAD photos from the run tank that we designed and manufactured, the PCS, as we call it, the pressure control system, which is the coupler between the run tank and the engine compartment. But it also houses all the plumbing system of the rocket. You can see 2 ball valves with 2 servos that are actuated when the time comes. So the right picture is the actual engine itself with the fuel grain inside. You can see the injector orifices. I will have a close-up view in the next slide, and the rocket engine's nozzle. So these are the close-up views that I mentioned before. You can see the injector with the tiny orifices. The orifices serve the purpose to atomize the liquid nitrous oxide coming from the run tank in order to react better with the fuel and in order to burn the fuel. Actually, in the middle, it's the plumbing system, but a more close view. And the nozzle assembly. The nozzle is made from graphite because it can resist high temperature and stuff. And a cut version of the whole propulsion system assembled. So Cronos will be able to lift 4 kilograms of a 3U CubeSat format payload and deploy it when it reaches apogee of 3 kilometers, as I mentioned before. But we need to recover the rocket. We cannot land it propulsively, not yet at least. So we need to eject 2 parachutes as well as the payload. So in order to eject the parachutes and the payload, we made and designed a recovery system using CO2 cartridges. When the time comes, the flight PC gives a signal to two DC motors. The DC motors are actuated. The CO2 cartridges are pushed up. They're getting pierced, and the piston rises, throwing everything outside. The flight computer is made in a PQ9 format. We use the standard format that you all know, I think, from the Libre Space Foundation. So we use these formats too for our development. And now, this is the recovery system made and tested. The middle one is a photo from a high-speed photo during a test. You cannot see the piston system there, but we just needed to test if the CO2 cartridges are actually punctured. So that was the reason we preferred to do this test. Now to the fun and interesting part. That's our rocket. So in order to have a scale, it has a diameter of 14 centimeters and a length of 3.7 meters. So you can clearly see at the top that we have carbon fiber structures. We designed them and manufactured them at the Hackerspace here in Athens. So you can see the nose cone with a metal tip, the body tube, it's made from carbon fiber tube also, and the fins are from carbon fiber too, except for the middle section that we have acrylic, because we have the avionics bay there that I presented to you earlier, and carbon fiber tubes with RF signals do not go hand by hand, so we need to have another medium to pass through, so we have acrylic. The cut version in the middle, you can see starting right from right to left, you can see the propulsion again, the engine, the PCS, the tank, then the recovery system, then the main parachute with its lines, the drogue parachute with its lines again, and the three U-cubes at the format payload right below the nose cone. The third picture is from a program that we used to simulate the rocket's trajectory. It's called Open Rocket, and that's the CAD translated to weight components in order to simulate the trajectory. The slide is not working. Yeah, so these are close-up views of the whole assembly. Again, at the left, you can see the propulsion system, the engine, etc., with the fins. The middle one is a configuration that the rocket will have when it's vertical on the latch band before launch. We need, by the safety regulations of any of the common sense that we have, to load the rocket empty, of course, because it's not good to load the rocket with 55 bars of pressurized oxidizer. So we need to fill it. In order to do that, we have the PCS, we have four carbon fiber plates that are removable in order to access the quick release line that we connect to the external run tank. And then when the time comes, we begin with the fill procedure, disconnect the quick line, place the igniter in the engine, put the carbon fiber plates back and be ready for launch. And at the right, you can see a cross-cut version of the nose cone. We have a metal tip because it must withstand all the aerodynamic forces and pressures on the top of the rocket, but we don't want the outer carbon fiber cell to support the actual weight of the metal tip, so we put a carbon fiber rod in the middle, so the cell can only withstand the aerodynamic stresses during flight. So now, as far as the simulations go, you can see the logo of Fusion 360 with a closed source program. Follow me through, it will make sense, I promise. Cronos started as a non-open source project. Okay, we are just a student team. We were like, okay, we'll make our project and everything will be fine. However, after some months, we came in contact with the Libre Space Foundation that, as I mentioned, the rocket is developed under the auspices of LSF, and we took the open source ideology along with the project. So we had to transition from closed source programs to open source, so from MATLAB to Octave, etc. However, a lot of work was already done in order to change the CAD software. So unfortunately, we had to stick with Fusion 360. However, we upload all of our files in the GitLab in step format so everyone can access them. And also we use FreeCAD for every simulation that we do. We run a finite element analysis, vibrational analysis, CFD analysis in FreeCAD, and everything works fine. I can verify it. When learning FreeCAD, we had to test first in SOLIDWORKS and other closed programs that we already knew from the school to test, and it was perfect. So you can see that we use Excel sheets in order to simulate basic calculations, so we can avoid doing everything by hand, like calculating shear stresses of bolts and stuff. Octave, because we transitioned from MATLAB, of course, for more advanced simulations. And of course, our favorite Open Rocket to simulate trajectories. It's the best thing ever. So these are some photos from the finite element analysis we run with FreeCAD. You can see the coupler. That's the coupler that is around the PCS, as you saw before. And the same coupler is used in the recovery system. We use the same part twice. So we designed one. It was fully over-engineered. It had a safety factor of 8, I think, or something like that. We ran finite element analysis. It was over-engineered, so we redesigned it and came with a second coupler that you can see on your right. You already saw it before in the CAD with a safety factor of 3. We verified the results of FreeCAD. They were accurate. They were completely accurate. And moving on, it's another simulation of the CFD of our nose cone. Now you might ask why you put only the nose cone, because it has drags and stuff. Doesn't it completely mess up your whole simulation? Yes and no. Yes, because it takes a lot of iterations to run in order to calculate the wake drag and all of that stuff shown there with blue. However, we only wanted to see how the flow separates from the contour of the nozzle. And the wake drag is far enough that it doesn't mess with the flow separation. You can see the flow separation with a red, a little orange part. That's where the flow separates. So that's with FreeCAD. Again, it's verified with other programs that we already knew before starting. It's completely accurate, as I mentioned before. Now, that's the Open Rocket. We love it. It's one of the best easy systems to simulate model rocket trajectories. We have a hard time simulating with Open Rocket because we have a hybrid system, which means that we have to simulate the mass loss of our run tank, not only the engines. However, we managed to do that with a dummy motor, as we call it. It's a motor that produces zero thrust, but it has the mass flow. And you can see a table at the bottom which says results max values. That's from an Excel trajectory calculator that we made when we didn't knew the aerodynamic packet of the rocket. So we just wanted to see how much thrust should our engine produce in order to lift so many kilograms up. You can see it's pretty close. Of course, it's not accurate, but it's pretty close with Open Rocket simulation. However, the Open Rockets are a lot better results. So some cool photos to close. That's the test stand that we designed. We need to verify that the engine actually produces the thrust that we need. We do this with this contraption right there. We want to have both of the tanks vertical, and the external tank and the tank that will fly with the rocket, because we needed to simulate the actual fill procedures of the whole process. And conveniently enough, the vertical part of the test stand was used to drill the holes on the run tank, the vertical holes. You can see in the third picture there, the run tank is supported at the background. It was really convenient that this happened. It served the purpose of the drilling jig, you can say. And some more cool random photos. You can see the injector orifice there, the Rev1 and the Rev2, the control box, the run tank of the third photo with the recovery system and the plumbing system, and the internal parts of the Mark I engine that we designed at the right. So that's what I have to present about our project. I hope you liked our rocket. OK, I already see questions on the public chat. Should I just answer?
Yeah, well, first, Thanos, that was great. That's amazing. And I always envy people who have such braveness to work with rockets. My experience with rockets is there was this water rocket with a Coca-Cola bottle. They put two bars in it. Then this thing went up, and at one point it came down, and everyone was running because there was no parachute on it. And that's already this. I was so afraid, you know, to get hit by a rocket. So and there was not even fire in it. There was actually just water.
So, yeah, I can understand.
Let's open the floor to questions. Fernando, you take over.
Yeah, we have a question from the from Sujan, that he's asking, how do you pump the oxidizer engine?
So that's a really good question, because you would assume that we would have a separate pressure tank in order to pump it. However, N2O has a really, really amazing property of self-pressurization, which means because the N2O has a really low triple point, it, when with the appropriate temperature, of course, you can make it self-pressurized by the container, by the dimensions of the container. So if you have, let's say that you have, with a magical reason, a completely empty tank filled only with liquid nitrous oxide, without water, without air or anything. If you have a compartment empty, the nitrous oxide will evaporate with a steady rate in order to keep this empty part of the container at exactly 55 bars. So we calculate inside our run tank how much oxidizer will get evaporated in order to have the steady pressure, and we add it to the propellant's weight again. So the 5.68 kilograms that I presented are calculated with the added oxidizer that needs to be evaporated in order to keep the steady pressure. So that's how the pressure, that's how we pump the N2O into the combustion chamber. It's just the N2O's properties. It's amazing.
Okay. A lot of people congratulating your work in the YouTube channel.
Oh, thank you. Okay, I see another question in the public chat.
Yes.
Is there any documentation overtures? Yeah, you can find a repository under the LSF repo. It's Cronos Rocket. We upload all the CAD files, all the simulation files, the result, everything. If something is not uploaded yet, it's because the Mark II closed the design 2 days ago. So yeah, we must tidy it up a bit and then upload it. But everything is under the LSF repo, Cronos Rocket. You will find it, and we use the Cerno HL license for every hardware component that we use.
Mm-hmm. Do we have another question on the channels?
Not so far.
Otherwise, I was wondering, because it's a student project, and I mean, you need some incentive to keep the students motivated and running this project. Is there some support from your university in this regards?
So, it's the bare minimum, we could say. We need some documents for the competition. They sign the documents and off we go. We have some exceptions of some teachers, because they are good people and they want to help us. However, it's mostly done by ourselves. We don't have a lot of support. Like you can imagine that we don't work at our university. Our lab is the hackerspace. We don't have a lab in the university because no one gives us a lab or something. So why stick there?
Okay, sounds familiar. We also did build a CubeSat, and first the professors, they were like, no way, you cannot do that, and we don't support you. And that changed completely towards the end.
Yeah.
So keep going.
Thank you.
And thanks for this nice presentation.
Thank you very much.
And yeah, so we go over to our next presentation. It's Anita.